We're delighted to announce that we have today Professor Matthew Budoff, who's going to talk to us about the EVAPORATE trial and the research in general on the new forms of fish oil. And this is a conceptually very simple and attractive therapy. And there's been a couple of very exciting studies that Matthew, welcome to the program. Thank you for agreeing. So some people may be aware that there was a little bit of unfortunate tension between me and Matt, because I said a few things on Twitter. So he's come on to the show to set the record straight and talk about those two trials. Could you just give us a couple of minutes outline of what they are, the endpoint trial and then the mechanism study?
Certainly. So the REDUCE-IT trial was a large multinational randomized placebo-controlled trial looking at over 8,000 patients randomized to 4 grams of icosapent ethyl or matching placebo and followed for events over 4.9 years. At the end of the trial, when they hit the number of events as an event-driven trial, the trial was stopped and they found a 25% event reduction.
And then came the EVAPORATE trial.
Yeah, so, excuse me. So in parallel with REDUCE-IT, while REDUCE-IT was ongoing.
That's actually quite important. So if I, just for the fellows to understand, you had this big trial which was done for endpoints, but the idea, because you need the endpoints in the end to get the FDA, et cetera, but it's that huge number will not agree to come and have stuff done to themselves repeatedly, necessarily. Right. Yeah. And so you can do a smaller trial to study the mechanisms and run them in parallel.
Exactly. So this was done as a mechanistic study. We knew that from the Japanese trials of EPA, the JELIS trial, that triglycerides only went down nominally. So it probably wasn't driven by a triglyceride reduction. So we wanted to understand why in JELIS and potentially in REDUCE-IT, we would see event reduction and understand the mechanism. So we did, as REDUCE-IT was ongoing, we did the EVAPORATE trial. We matched the patients for entry criteria, for lipids, triglyceride values, LDL values. We matched them for randomization. It was a double-blind placebo-controlled trial, again, randomizing.
So when you said you matched them, so what you were saying is that's not matching the two arms, that was matched by randomization,
exactly.
But you matched them by ensuring that they were representative of the big trial.
Exactly, so by entry criteria, by randomization to drug, and by the same therapy. So we gave them again 4 grams of icosapent ethyl or placebo and followed them this time for 18 months to look at plaque progression using cardiac CT. So we did serial CT angiography to look for plaque progression and we found a modest slowing of plaque progression with icosapent ethyl.
Okay. So the controversy on Twitter, for which I'm partly responsible, I have to admit. Let me start by looking at the thing which people told me about, which I wasn't aware about at the time, that in both the big trial and the EVAPORATE mechanism trial, the control arm was a placebo, but it was a particular thing, a mineral oil placebo. And to me, that sounds reasonable because you know, we use paraffin as like a laxative or something, you know, this is stuff that shouldn't be absorbed in the body. So it didn't actually matter what it is. But the odd thing is, in the online supplement of the mega trial, there is the effects on the lipids, etc. And it just looks like there's a delta worsening in the mineral oil group, which is more than any effect in the active drug group. Is that something you have some comment about? That it just, you know, you'd expect placebo to have almost no effect.
Yeah, and to be honest, you know, we had no idea. This wasn't known when we started either trial. As you said, you know, they picked mineral oil because it's theoretically a non-absorbable therapy that's been used in doses for safely for as a laxative for decades, if not longer. And it matched very nicely with the constituency and the color of icosapent ethyl. So they chose it because it would prevent unblinding. So people couldn't pierce the capsule and figure out that they're on placebo or icosapent ethyl.
And so that's actually very important. So we tried to do a statin against placebo trial. The most half the cost of the trial was getting the placebo made so that you couldn't pierce it and work out what it is.
So when we did the evaporate trial, they wanted us to use the same placebo because, again, we were trying to match reduce it, and we didn't know about any of the potential controversy, or obviously I would have suggested a different placebo had I known that might have occurred. So that was a surprise, and
probably some of it is getting absorbed and having some sort of lipid-like effect, I guess.
Yeah, it looks like it produces a very mild, but does have a systemic.
In a big trial, you see it. Everything becomes significant, you know, that side when you have pre-post. Yeah, so that's trial. So I wasn't really aware of any of that discussion about mineral oil. But what struck me is this table, which I don't know if you've looked at since, the table in the evaporate trial. So this is a thing, and I'm sorry I turned it into a little bit of a comedy thing, but normally both arms start off about the same, and then they sort of diverge with time. And then typically what would happen is the control arm stays the same or gets a bit worse, and the active arm sort of stays the same, for example. But what we saw here was the two arms started off apart and then sort of converged together at the end and ended up rather similar.
So you're talking about specifically just the low attenuation plaque.
So I'm looking at table two.
Yep.
And I see it really for about five out of the six types of plaque. I forget exactly which five, but calcification, fibrofatty, fibrous, low attenuation, total non-calcified, and total plaque. Obviously they're correlated because they're overlapping, you know, things. But it was just odd that they are so different at the beginning and end up so samey near the end. Is that something that struck? So that's what caused me to say, maybe it's unblinded, because then when people are assessing the, you know, active arm, you might think, which is, by the way, of course, why people blind trials to stop that from happening. Yeah. And I'm sorry that got sent to you in a way that was very, you know, angry making, but it was a way that I could reason that you could have, groups starting off different, even though they're randomized and should be roughly speaking the same, usually. Had you noticed that at all in the data?
And I have to say small numbers. We were hoping, we were anticipating that the groups would be well matched at baseline. The baseline characteristics were well matched as it worked out. But there are, you know, especially when you're dealing with very small plaque volumes. Remember, these numbers are astronomically small volumes. So a few patients can throw off a value for a mean. Yeah. When you have small ends. So I think it is a limitation that we readily admit. The sample size is small and therefore.
But it's big enough to show the effect. And also, you know, the clinical characteristics, the things that you randomize and then there's no measurement involved. It's like, you know, their age and gender and that kind of stuff. In that, the randomization seems to have worked and the two arms are fairly similar. Their distribution of the p-values for the differences are evenly spread, which is what you'd expect, which is what typically happens. And then the thing that is measured in the core lab is the one that looks different at baseline. So that's what, you know, that to explain that I wasn't just randomly saying that.
And we had the same thing happen in a paper we published in JAMA with testosterone, where the groups, just by randomization, the plaque volumes started out significantly different.
And they converge to be more same near the end.
Yeah, and they. I mean, I don't say that, maybe not to this degree, but they definitely, there was progression in the group that had less plaque at baseline. There was more stabilization. You know, it's not unheard of. There was a paper out of Boston as well. I forgot the exact first author that also had this occur, where the results, at least, you know, to the naked eye, when you just group them, look like they converge more at the end. So I can't say this is impossible to occur. It's obviously, you know, I don't think it represents unblinding in any way. I can assure you I'm still blinded because we're still doing
subsequent analyses. Things.
Yeah, so myself and the readers are completely blinded to this point. The only person who's unblinded is the statistician. I understand your point when you look at the table.
Obviously, I apologize. It wasn't me that made fun of the figure two, where it just, you know, most people, when they show a typical example, actually pick their best one, which actually is not a good advice to do because you give everyone a wrong representation of what an echo looks like or an x-ray looks like. So in this particular example, everything is sort of happening simultaneously, but it happens to be two reconstructions which look different, and one of them you can see the nearby vessel and the other one you can't, etc. But
we have a better one that we used for the presentation that looks more parallel. I'm not exactly sure why the people doing the editing chose that figure, but we do have a better figure that I presented at a European Society of Cardiology that does show more parallel plaque changes.
So is the rate of progression in the control arm in the placebo group in the EVAPORATE trial? I mean, so one challenge I had was, when I look at these data in table two, they're log transformed, yes? So they're the kind of logarithms of the original values. So to me, that's actually quite a big change in size of plaque. So if the log goes up by, you know, say one of them, low attenuation, say, goes up by 0.9 units, that's more than doubling of plaque in that time, of that kind of plaque. And obviously I've picked the number that's largest, but they go between 0 and 0.9. So it just, does this study make you think that the rate of atherosclerosis in the placebo arm might actually be contributing to the significance of the result? Because it just seems faster than people see longitudinally otherwise.
Well, yeah, and I wouldn't focus too much. I realize low attenuation plaque is, you know, stands out as the greatest difference, but the numbers are very, very small. So again, they could be driven at least to some degree by the changes in a few that drove that number up. And the absolute values are very, very small. I mean, remember, we have thousands of millimeters cubed of volume in our coronary arteries. Yeah. And if we add another 40% for Glagoff and remodeling, you know, we have huge volumes, and this represents less than 1 millimeter cubed. So it did double in that one arm in that one 18-month period. But if we look at, let's say, non-calcified, total non-calcified plaque.
But remember, can I just go back and check? I don't think we're talking about 1 millimeter cubed. So when it goes up from baseline one to, say, let's pick the top one, calcification. So where it goes from 2.9 to 3.3, if these are log transformed units, then that's 10 to the power 2.9 to 10 to the power 3.3, or, you know, 2.7 to the power 2.9. So the increase isn't the percentage increase from 2.9 to 3.3. It's the base of the exponent raised to the power 0.4. So that's why I reckon that even that top one, 2.9 to 3.3, is an increase of 0.4 log units. And that would be not just like a 10, 15% increase, but a, you know, 50, 60% increase. I can calculate it, but it's, so that's what strikes me. So when you say log transformed, do you mean you've just taken the numbers and taken the logarithms, or was it a different group that maybe statistical group that did all that?
Yeah, I mean, the statistical group did that. And I can only attest that, you know, not only did the, you know, the it was natural log transformed.
Fantastic. Oh, that helps, because then we can calculate the increase from e to the power 3.3 to e to the, to, x3, I'm just doing it here, sorry about this, x3.9. It's 49, so going from 2.9 to 3.3, if they're natural logs, is a 49% increase. That's that top one. So it just looks like it'd be a good thing worth going back and checking with the your forearmed next time somebody asks you.
Yep, no, and yeah, we had the yeah. So I'll look into that specific question whether I think these are the absolute numbers and then they log transform the difference. But
that would explain it.
I'm pretty sure these are the absolute values at baseline and follow up, and then then they log transform the difference. But I'll try to get back to you on that, because that's honestly a statistics is not my strongest suit.
That would help. So if we knew that would shut a lot of people up, including me. So that's fine. You know, part of on Twitter is you just say what you like.
Of course. No, and we had so we did have a statistician do the work. We did have an external statistician then confirm the work for the publication. So I know they're correct, but I'll have to look into that methodology specifically to address that difference. To see, because that's something I didn't understand from the Twitter feeds. That part of the criticism I didn't understand until you just explained it to me. I'll have to go back and talk to my statisticians, and I'll get back to you on that.
No, this is great. So I just, part of the reason for this is for the on Twitter. I'm actually a big fan of Twitter because at least it creates the discussion very quickly. Obviously, if two people have different levels of experience of Twitter, it's very frightening. It seemed like a perfectly sensible thing. It actually seems perfectly sensible to me prospectively. And we didn't know. And if we knew that it was going to mess up the cholesterols and it would create a question mark, we'd just pick something else. Right. And so, the important thing we're trying to do in this channel is for fellows to understand that these thought processes go on. Because when we present at a conference, everything is like super, super cleaned up, summarized.
And just to that point, I just want to say that, in normal times when we're at meetings and we're presenting, these are the valuable insights that the investigators get as well. This feedback when we present our posters in the poster hall and people come up and ask questions that we could potentially clarify, or when we present on the big stage and then afterwards we have these discussions, it's very helpful for the investigative team as well to understand, to make sure that we can clarify this.
And I learn a great deal. Yeah. So when I present stuff and then people ask me things, I might think that's a stupid question, but actually I also think it's because I didn't explain it. And actually, I should be scared, because when I submit this as a paper, somebody's going to think that as well. So I need to prevent that problem from happening. So science is a very collegial thing.
A lot of times we get too close to this work. This is my, 30th prospective trial on CT angiography. I didn't, I haven't gone into the weeds in the statistics in the other ones. So, it didn't really dawn on me to that this question would come up, but obviously it's an important one that we need to further evaluate.
And also for fellows who get nervous about presenting, you should actually, if you are like Matt and me, where you've been presenting all the time, you spend all your time thinking about the research. So it's actually very, you don't get stressed before a presentation, or maybe a big late breaking trial or something, but because you have all the things in your head and you have no worries that you can't answer the question. You just have worries that you're going to fluff and not say something properly. Whereas for the fellows, they're always scared about the questions. But I don't know. It's just the questions someone would ask you in a bar, your colleague about why you would do it, but they get nervous about it. So if there's anything else you'd like to say about the study to throw in?
Well, I would just say, I think that you know, we learned so much from presenting this work and understanding the, you know, and after the study's done, obviously, you know, hindsight is 2020, and now we can go back in our next study that we're going to do. We're obviously not going to use mineral oil as a placebo.
That's a really powerful insight, because you can't write that in the paper. You look stupid. Yeah. So people say they're unrepentant for using it. Well, no, because that's the paper. They can't say we wish we hadn't, because it's embarrassing to write that in the paper. But actually, in person, you say, "Yeah, we wish we hadn't. We're not insane."
obviously, that was just what they were doing in Reduce It, and we emulated Reduce It because we thought that would provide the best comparison of if there is a benefit, if we do see slowing of plaque progression, then that would potentially be
mechanism by which the drug makes 100% sense to use the same for both. And it, prospectively, it sounds like a great choice to me. I would have said it shouldn't have any effect. So
I have to say that we did look at mineral oil rates of progression in Evaporate, so the placebo arm, and we did compare it to a cellulose-based tablet.
Yes, I was going to ask you about that.
We did another analysis to try to address this to see if there was more rapid progression, and the progression rates actually look fairly parallel. We published that in Cardiovascular Research earlier in the year.
No, I saw that. I saw that paper, and I thought that's a very clever analysis. And the basis for that, for the fellow's benefit, is that maybe mineral oil is harmful, and in which case it will cause accelerated progression. But the way to catch that is to use the other population with a different placebo, which was a kind of biological oil type thing. I forget what it was, but it was oil, but different. And it was a placebo for garlic. So there is absolutely no reason. I mean, they might both be harmful, but there is no reason why they should be the same amount harmful. That is impossible. It's like tossing a coin and it landing on its edge. And so that was actually quite interesting. And that's what made me think, well, maybe the analysis was where the problem was. And maybe there was some bias in the analysis. But if it was all blinded, then, you know, and you're still blinded. So that's as good as the analysis can get. We know the randomization was random because the baseline characteristics are random, you know, so nothing went wrong there. So it's just one of those mysteries. It just happened twice.
So we did at least try to address that issue after the fact. I think, you know, obviously we continue to learn how to better perform these studies. And this was just one where we were kind of, I'd say force-fed, but kind of forced to use mineral oil at the time.
I wouldn't say forced. I mean, for both trials, it seemed like a reasonable choice.
Right. By the time we tried to evaporate, Reduce It was already ongoing, and we wanted to truly emulate the Reduce It trial as closely as possible. So we did. We were kind of, you know, it made sense at the time, as you said. Yeah.
So thank you very much for joining us. Thank you so much, Matt. Bye-bye.
Take care.